Welcome to episode 140 of the Startup Show. Today we are here at the office of Dani Gutenberg, who is a partner at VI Partners. And we are talking about the early days of when he invested in Facebook. We also talk about the importance of industry expertise, but last but not least, why you should be building a unicorn. Make sure to stay tuned. Welcome to episode 140 of the Startup Show. Today is very special because after a very long time, I finally have back on the show an investor. So, Dani, it's such a pleasure to have you on the show. Welcome. You know, as usual on the Startup Show, coming from interviewing so many startups, it would be great if you introduced yourself like in a few sentences about yourself.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm born and raised in Zurich, where I still spend most of my time. I'm having an engineering background. And I have started investing into startups in the mid-90s already. So I've been for a very long time in the business and still enjoy it very much to work with young, innovative and people full of energy.
Before every show, we make a little bit of research. We ask common friends and shared connections on LinkedIn what they would like to know. And one of the questions that came up from, I think, even two people is that they wanted to know about your background from Hawaii. that's what they said. Like, there is some interesting story about like how you built basically from nothing. So maybe you can elaborate a little bit like on the early days.
So even before Hawaii, I was first in California, University of Santa Barbara. Became a ski bum in Utah for 4 months. And when the season was over, I got myself by pure luck and coincidence a job as a windsurf instructor in Hawaii.
Yeah.
And I spent 3 years in Hawaii until I couldn't be there anymore because of lack of a work permit and a visa. That's when I started my career in IT.
Mm-hmm. And then you had like NetScape, what was it, like one of the software companies?
I had a distribution business that I started in Switzerland. The company was called Gutenberg Communication Systems. I was distributing different products. One of them was of a Swedish company, Axis, that was just sold now to Canon for almost $3 billion. And very early on, I contacted a very small, at that time, very small company called NetScape, if I could do their distribution in Europe. And they happily said yes. They were already busy with the US. And this, of course, was the beginning of the internet.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the internet started. Because I had Netscape, everybody else also wanted to be distributed. So I became a distributor for Intershop and AltaVista and Oracle and many of those companies that helped the internet go where it is today.
Mm-hmm. How do you handle, like, let's say, this feeling of taking these risks of like starting something by yourself? And then also, you know, when you think of like investing, like taking this risk of giving someone money?
First of all, I'm a risk taker, but not a crazy one. I always try to calculate the risk return, and I will only take a risk if there is a good chance of a good return, or if I feel that I have to do it because it's helping the world to be a better world. I really try to minimize the risk as much as I can, and I have a set of key parameters that I learned over the years on how to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I never gamble all my money on one or all my time on one project. I always try to have several projects and several possibilities. And I always had that already when I was a distributor of Netscape. If you remember, I was doing a large business with Netscape, and one day Netscape called me. There was this big war going on between Netscape and Microsoft Explorer, where Explorer was for free. And Netscape was $17.90 per license, and that was a big part of my business, but I never based everything on that. I always had a few other income streams that was very important for me to have. And one day I get a call from Netscape, and they told me, you know, from tomorrow on, Netscape is for free. So my whole business died, or my Netscape business died in one day. But luckily enough, I had another 10 lines, AltaVista, and a few other things that would sustain me and that helped me come over this really difficult situation.
Right.
And that's exactly the same thing as I do today with my startups. I always, I don't put all my eggs in one basket, all in one startup. I try to always have 10, 20, 30 startups running at the same time so that I won't lose everything if one or two go down the drain.
Sure. You are now currently a partner at VI Partners. Maybe you can explain to us a little bit like what your focus is there, what kind of startups are you looking for, and you know what kind of stages you invest.
Venture Incubator is not only currently, by the way, I've been there for 15 years now, it has 10 large investors. Each of them invested a substantial amount of money. They are Nestle, Novartis, Credit Suisse, Hilti, ABB, ZKB, all large Swiss companies. We are four partners managing that, two on the life sciences side, two on the technology side. And we're actually adding one on each side yet now. We invest in early stage, seed stage. We are very close to the ETH and mm-hmm. the universities in Switzerland. We invest only in Swiss companies. Except for rare cases where we go surrounding of Switzerland. We invest up to a maximum of 10 million per company, but usually we would start at 50, 100,000 or a few hundred thousand. And then in subsequent rounds, we'll augment that.
One of the interesting things what I was really excited to hear about is your early investment in Facebook. Probably also a story you've told a few times already, but maybe you can reflect a little bit back. What I'm curious to know is like, what made you think back then, I think it was 2007, if I remember exactly. correctly, that you made this investment. How were you able to tell back then? What were these key parameters? You say like, well, Mark is the guy that can do that, and Facebook is the solution to some kind of problem.
So it was really interesting. It was in December of 2006, actually. I invested in 2007, but in December of 2006, I already had looked at Facebook for like 6 months. I had requested to talk to the CFO, Gideon Yu at the time, a Chinese guy. We had a phone call on the 24th of December, actually, where we discussed his numbers. And I just couldn't believe his numbers. I mean, they were like so much growing in the last 3 months since I last talked about the numbers. Not with him, but with somebody else. That the discrepancy was so big, I just couldn't believe him. And you have to remember, it was at that time a very small company, only 2 years old. And I just told him, listen, Gideon, I don't even believe you're really the CFO of Facebook. I mean, those numbers sound really phony to me. That might be a scam. So he said then and there on the phone, listen, Daniel, I'll connect you now as my friend on Facebook. And if you still don't believe that I am the CFO of Facebook, don't invest, because then you don't understand the business model of Facebook. So he connected me, and within a second, while I'm still on the phone, I can see that he's friends with John Doerr, a famous Silicon Valley investor, with Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos from Amazon. And so I knew immediately, okay, this is the guy. In that second, it dawned to me that the only way that on the 24th of December, between mm-hmm. California and Switzerland, you could prove who you are is Facebook. There is no other way on earth that he could have proven who he is. And up to this day, I believe this is the biggest business model of Facebook in the future, which they haven't monetized yet on. And that's why I'm still today a Facebook investor, actually.
Yeah. What would that be, this business model that they haven't invested yet?
The passport of the internet.
Really?
That you can prove who you are. Yes, absolutely.
Interesting, interesting. One of the things I think as an investor, you know, it's sometimes very hard also, like when you try to build a reputation as an investor, you know, one out of 10 only succeeds as a general statistic. And many times it's also when you look at the journalistic perspective, it's hard to say take in negative feedback because, you know, some of these companies go bad. How do you handle, let's say, this feedback when negative feedback comes in and it's hard to, let's say, deal with, let's say, the struggles of a startup?
Of course, feedback is feedback, and I think it's, mm-hmm. it's always valuable. And you try to listen as much to it as you can process and use. And on the other hand, you also have to say those startups usually do something that has never been done before. And you need to be able to also say, this is my vision and I'm going to try it, or going to let them try their vision. And until proven wrong, they should go in that direction. When I invested into Facebook, all my friends told me, you're totally crazy, don't do that. Do invest in MySpace. MySpace is the leader. And Facebook will never have a chance to get this kind of a market share. Mm-hmm. And at the end, it turned out differently, mm-hmm. as you know.
No, for sure. What is it, let's say, about this whole investment process that like excites you so much to be like in this, let's say, VC world for the last, I don't know, 25 years, 30 years?
So I really like to have the best solution for a certain problem.
Yeah.
So to have a long thought process beforehand and then have a theory and then be able to go from theory to proof. That is really what excites me.
And when you say, like, for example, one of the things that I always see also, like, when I'm preparing for my show sometimes, it's very hard to have, like, an expertise within all of these different industries. When you have, let's say, multiple, let's say you try to diversify the risk and you have different verticals and different industries, how do you cope with that?
My business model, as a venture capitalist is not to know the depths of the business. I think you have no chance if you invest in stuff that will only, you know, that is so much at the bleeding edge of the technology. You have no chance to know more than the professors at the university, is not even close that much. So I really try to focus my selection criteria on people. Mm-hmm. So I hope and I try and I think that I need to be able to understand if I'm talking to a winner or not. And if the person, the CEO in this case, will be able to go through with his vision or not. And that's the, I would say, 80% based of my decision is on that and not on the technology or the understanding of the technology. And because of that, I really invest very, very broadly. I do privately everything from life sciences investments to deep tech investments and everything in between.
Mm-hmm. You said you also like investing privately. How do you, let's say, distinguish between when you're investing in as a VI partner versus, let's say, privately?
So everything I do in Switzerland is with VI partners.
Yeah.
VI partners, like I said before, only invest in Swiss company.
Yeah.
And what I do outside of Switzerland, I do private.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that like I think is always interesting, when you are involved in so many startups, how you dedicate your time to each project. So how do you decide, like, okay, how much time you're allocating, especially as a board member, to different types of startups?
I'm trying to allocate the most time where I bring the most in result. Time has shown that I can help the companies, especially in the first 3 years when they put together the seed round and A and B round, to help them get the right mix of investors and the right pitch deck and the right markets and the right partnerships. And then usually in the growth stage, there's not that much value I can add. And then where I can add again is at the exit stage, when mm-hmm. it's about who do you want to deal with for the exit, how do you want to legally structure it, what are the key parameters that you are, or the key players that you want to work with on the exit.
Mm-hmm. Definitely would have been the next question. Like once you like went through such a long stage with these startups such as Facebook, Mobileye, for example, also, and then you finally get to this stage of like what you were hoping for, which is the exit or an IPO. How is it, let's say, number one, the feeling of getting there and saying like now this is the moment of the, let's say, the big returns? And number two, also like to let go of, let's say, part of your investment that you kind of built up.
Also, my own company, Gutenberg Communication Systems, when I sold it, everybody told me, how were you able to let go of your baby? And I don't have that big of an attachment, I have to say, to those companies. I invest for the goal of somehow selling it. And with Mobileye as well. I mean, the point of my big enjoyment or excitement mm-hmm. is when with Mobileye we had 80%, 90% world market share in autonomous car electronics. That really, really excited me. Mm-hmm. And that was already 3-4 years before the exit. The exit at the end of the day was a nice exit, and that's what I'm living from, but it's not what really excites me. What really excites me is to, you know, having had a theory in the year 2000 about autonomous cars, and then in the year 2015 or, you know, 14, be able to say, and our theory was right, everybody else thought you need two cameras or you need radar and cameras, and we did it all with one camera, and we have 80% market share. That's what the real pleasure is, not the exit by itself, right. Really.
I mean, when you look at, let's say, the venture capital industry in the next couple of years, do you see, like, any trends in terms of, like, how venture capital will be done in the next couple of years? Or do you think, like, the industry will stay the way it is now?
I don't think there's a secret magic sauce that will, you know, change everything. There is trends, of course. At one point, everything will be on the blockchain and it will be much easier to transact, much less paper, hopefully, and much less lawyers involved, hopefully. Sorry about the lawyers that look at this. But I mean, the whole transaction will be easier. It will be hopefully also possible with smaller amounts, with more that more people can invest in startups. But at the end of the day, you still need, you know, good execution, which means good people with good vision, with a problem that needs to be solved.
Yeah. So let's look a little bit again into the future. When you look at, let's say, the Facebook of 2007 today, what is it, let's say, the companies that you would say, like, you have to be, or let's say it doesn't have to be a company specifically, but let's say the trends that you see now that are relevant for the next, let's say, 15, 20 years.
So you mean I can't do publicity for my own startups?
No, you can. But I'm saying, like, I'm more interested, like, you know, like in the industry and the verticals that you think, like, are going to be big.
Verticals for sure. Everything that has to do with banking will be massively changed. There is way too much money going into just handling banking, and that with fintech will be changed a lot. Crypto will have a big influence. I think we're totally underestimating delivery drones for goods, but also for persons. VTOLs and this stuff, we're totally underestimating how fast that will come. I'll predict that autonomous cars will be mass produced and mass used within 2 years from now.
2 years.
Which nobody can believe, but I'm pretty sure.
and market share by Tesla, the majority.
No. Doesn't have to be Tesla. I actually predict it's going to be somebody else.
Yeah.
But I'm not even sure in which country or continent that's going to be. So,
yeah.
But the technology is here today already. And I think in 2 years we will be ready for mass production.
Yes.
In some places on the world, maybe not, you know, here in Zurich, depending on legislation. And then I predict that we will have autonomous drones even before that.
Mm-hmm.
In also mass usage or consumer usage.
That's within the next 12 months. And
so yeah, pretty much. We are actually, I have a project where we are already in Iceland are delivering food, sushi and other stuff, and also electronics with drones in Reykjavik, in a large part of Reykjavik already. We have been doing that for more than a year, and now got the permission to deliver to more people.
Mm-hmm.
And we are starting the same project in the US now. So, it will be within months.
Right. Interesting. So one last question for the first part of the interview is, what do you see, let's say, in the local startup ecosystem here in Switzerland that you would say, like, makes this ecosystem so unique?
The USP of the Swiss ecosystem, I would say, is we have lots of money.
Yeah.
Lots of know-how from banking. We have lots of know-how in the universities. We have very well educated workforce.
Mm-hmm.
And all this together gives us an edge in certain industries.
Mm-hmm. What's your best valuation method for early stage startup?
My Tom.
Not gut feeling?
That's about the same as from my tongue to the gut feeling to the...
Yes, but no, but you mentioned before like five criteria or a couple of criteria that you have.
Yeah, of course. When you go in seed, you have no numbers that you can rely on. And at that stage, the key parameter is the CEO. Has he done it before? Or do I believe him that he will be able to do this? But basically, for me, it doesn't really matter that much. I mean, the valuation in seed rounds are always between, you know, 3 and 6 million. It does make a big difference if it's 3 or 6.
Yeah, on the long term.
On the long term, it doesn't make a big difference. And also on the short term, because it also depends a lot on a lot of other parameters.
Yeah.
That's why I also tell growth companies, I can give you 100 million valuation. That's no problem at all. Just let me do the terms. So you can't really take the valuation apart from the terms, which is very often done.
What are some tips for balancing work and life?
I'm probably the wrong person to ask. As my wife will tell you, I'm a total workaholic.
Yeah.
I try my best not to work too much and spend a lot of time more time now with my kids, and that's good.
Yeah. What's your best advice for someone who wants to start with a venture capital or to raise a fund?
Work somewhere in a startup before and try to go through all the stages of a startup, from paper through first, second, third raise, maybe to go broke or to an exit, or ideally both, of course.
Yes. What do you think was your biggest mistake as a venture capitalist?
Oh, there's so many mistakes. I do them on a daily basis. I don't think that's my biggest mistake, but many people will refer back to my possibility to invest in Uber when Uber had a 6 million valuation.
Yeah.
And I passed on it because I simply forgot.
You forgot. Okay, and the last question, who is your role model in the venture capital world?
My role model in the venture capital world is a guy called John Deere. I met him in 1997. He was the initial investor in all the big Silicon Valley companies and is still very active in the Silicon Valley. Wrote a very good book lately. He's the guy who really inspired me to become also a venture capitalist.
Okay. So the last part of the video is always where you get about 30 seconds to leave like a legacy on the video. Basically, you want to give some kind of advice to students or anybody who is out there who wants to get either hear your advice or number two, sit in your seat at some point.
My advice is your dreams shouldn't go to become a venture capitalist. I think you should become a founder and you should try to build a unicorn. As you know, I'm also called Unicorn Hunter. To build a unicorn, it's very easy. You should try to do a product that will convince a billion people or more to pay $1. And that automatically makes you a unicorn, and that automatically probably makes the world a better place, because if 1 billion people are ready to split with a dollar, then you probably have something, a solution that is really needed.
Dani, thank you so much for being on the show today. I really appreciate it. Thank you very much, everybody who tuned in to today's episode. Again, visit an investor after a long time, and make sure to stay a few more seconds to see who is up next week, and I'll see you in a bit. Have a great day.
Hi everybody, I'm Phil, CEO and founder of Advanon. Make sure to tune in next week for my full interview with Cedric from Global Tech Box. Thank you very much.